Welcome to Just a Minute. Nicholas Parsons, and as the minute waltz fades away, once more it's my huge pleasure to welcome our many listeners in this country and around the world, but also to welcome to the show four exciting, talented, dynamic players of this game, and they are seated on my right, Paul Merton and Tony Hawkes, and seated on my left, Graham Norton and Sheila Hancock. Please welcome all four of them. Beside me sits Sarah Sharp. She's going to help me keep the score and blow a whistle when the 60 seconds have elapsed. And we're going to begin with a great broadcaster, Graham Norton. Graham, here's an interesting subject. My personal assistant. I don't know whether you have one or not. But tell us something about that in this game starting now.
My personal assistant. Yes, I do have one. And no, I don't know why either. You're just supposed to. It's as if somehow I'm very busy and can't cope with all the demands of my life. This isn't really true. However, sometimes, oh, it's handy. At the moment, while I speak, my personal assistant, and this is true, is on a train to Bexhill to collect my phone because I left it there. Now, I could have done that tomorrow when, in fact, I'll be doing laundry. So is it more sensible to pay someone to wash my clothes so I'd be free to collect the mobile device from the seaside town I mentioned, or pay, oh, that's twice with the pay, to someone who could, stop, I've rambled.
No, you've actually been interrupted.
Said mobile twice,
I know he did.
Yeah. Oh, did I?
The subject was... believe that you actually sent somebody to get your phone from Bexhill.
It's worse to ask her to do some laundry for me tomorrow while I'm driving to Bexhill.
Well, with the money you earn, you could have bought a new mobile phone.
What's that about? That seems crazy. That seems worse. It seems worse to just abandon a phone. Otherwise, she'd just been sat in an office doing nothing.
As well as the bank.
Tomorrow's a busy day for her.
You could buy two phones, one for London and one for the country.
I could. You know what'll happen. I'll just leave them both somewhere. Mm.
Yeah. Let's get on with Just a Minute, shall we? Sheila, you've got 9 seconds to go on my personal assistant, starting now.
I'm getting to the age where I very much need personal assistance, crossing the road, putting the cat out. I have got a wonderful woman called Claire.
In this game, whoever is speaking when the whistle goes gains an extra point, and this occasion it was Sheila Hancock, who was the only one who got any points in that opening round. Tony Hawkes, we'd like you to begin the next round. The subject, A Tale of Two Cities. Tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now.
A Tale of Two Cities. I'm going to do a tour later this year, and one of the cities will be Exeter, the other Aberdeen. It's just a disappointment they're on consecutive nights and not very well planned by the manager of this event, as it happens. Dickens, of course, wrote a book called A Tale of Two Cities, 45 chapters or something. I remember reading it when I was little, set in Paris and London. Terrific read. Well done, Chaz. Now, if I was to stand on a small mound...
A poor chance.
Well, a hesitation slightly there.
Yeah, it was a slight hesitation. Paul, you have the subject. You have 17 seconds. On A Tale of Two Cities with you, Paul, starting now.
There have been several film adaptations of A Tale of Two Cities. One thinks fondly of Dirk Bogarde, creating a magnificent heroic role for British cinema. And if we go back further in time, Ronald Colman indeed essayed this very same character in Hollywood's golden...
Sheila Hancock.
He's a character.
Did I say character
I think
twice?
You said Dirk Bogarde invented a character.
Well, I might have done. I thought it was roll. Did I say roll first
Did you?
Time?
Maybe.
Roll, that's right. Yes, well done, Paul.
Well, we'll see in the repeat. I'll check it. Right. However, I'm willing to concede because I'm a good player.
You're a great player. That's why you keep coming back, my darling.
Because you can't get any other women to stand up to these men. It all stems from when Kenneth used to say you shouldn't have women on this show.
That's right, many years ago, yes. And you were one of the few who could stand up to him and shout him down. Paul, half a second to go.
Well, hang on, can I just remind people, I was the one challenged, so it's not really my fault that there's half a second to go.
Paul, half a second, starting now.
Liverpool and...
So, Paul, speaking as the whistle went, gained the extra point of others in the round. He's now taking the lead ahead of all the others. And, Sheila, we'd like you to begin the next round. The subject is making a difficult decision. What I have to do all the time in this show, but you tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now.
Do you know, I have discovered that trying to make decisions is the thing that makes me most ill. Occasionally I get a headache and I don't know why, and I think it's because I'm trying to make up my mind about something. Like in this game, I have to make a decision whether to interrupt, because then I will get a subject that possibly I know damn all about. So I think, what shall I do? Will I do that, press the buzzer, or will I actually sit tight? And I've repeated, will I?
Yes. Tony?
Yeah, repetition of will I.
Will I, yes. 31 seconds for you, Tony, making a difficult decision, starting now.
Whenever I have a difficult decision to make, I take myself down to the lakeside, sit there, pensively... Oh, I can't be bothered.
Graham, you challenge first.
Hesitation, I believe.
It was hesitation. Yes. Making a difficult decision, Graham, and there are 23 seconds starting now.
When I have to make a difficult decision, I think to myself, WMNPD, what might Nicholas Parsons do? Then I dwell on what action that great man might take, and with that thought in my mind, I sally forth, and that isn't the course of action I decide.
So Graham was then speaking as the whistle went. I'd like to give you a bonus point for all that flattery, Graham, but I can't favour people. You're in second place, just behind Paul Merton, and Paul, it's your turn to begin. The subject is ventriloquism. Tell us something about that subject in this game, starting now.
I've always had a big soft spot for ventriloquists. I remember with great affection one called Arthur Worsley, and his particular gimmick was that the dummy did all the talking, why he himself as a character never spoke. I also loved Neville King, and he had an old man dummy that was...
Graham Challenge.
Reputation of loved.
Yes. Yes. Yes, I did.
You loved Arthur Worsley?
Yeah, he was fantastic.
Pity we're going to have a whole history of all the different vents... Throughout the whole of the history
it's
of the
It's a fantastic... I love it, always loved it.
So Graham's gone in now. 45 seconds, ventriloquism starting now.
I recall one very special Christmas when I got a fort, a goldfish, and a ventriloquist dummy. His name was Finnegan. That was written on the box, and I could read. I was quite a smart child. It had ginger hair, a small cap with a sort of houndstooth check and a matching jacket. Black trousers, since you ask, and small plastic boots. It was mass manufactured, so probably wasn't the greatest ventriloquism.
Tony Challenge.
Was there a hesitation there?
There's hesitation in the middle of the word.
Well, I couldn't remember what the subject was, so I was good with whether I could say ventriloquist, but it's ventriloquism.
Ventriloquism, yes,
so I couldn't say that.
I will give it to you, Tony. Hesitation, 13 seconds, ventriloquism starting now.
A very funny ventriloquist act that my father used to find hilarious was Sandy Powell, who used to be inadequate, hopeless at doing it.
Sheila Challenge.
They were actually too used to.
That's right.
Oh,
who's used to do it and who's used to it.
Oh, well spotted.
And you have 3 seconds, Sheila, starting now.
Tommy Cooper used to make me roar when he tried to do a ventriloquist act.
So they all got points in the round. Sheila was speaking as a whistle when gained that extra one. She's equal to Paul in the lead. And Graham, it's your turn to begin.
Oh, yes.
And now the subject is the speaking clock. 60 seconds, starting now.
I am actually very fond of the old speaking clock, or Tim, as we used to call him. How droll. When I wasn't working as an actor, sometimes I would be called to auditions. I lived in fear of someday getting a job. So I developed a monologue from a fictitious play where I was the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.